Hello students, welcome you all for the fourth lecturing session on module 2, pumps and actuators. In the previous session, we had discussed about the classification of pump and the types of pumps like gear pump, vane pump and the piston pump and their types as well as the construction and the working. So in today's session, we are discussing about the numericals on the external gear pump as well as the vane pump. So very important one, in order to know the what are the parameters regarding to the numericals for the external gear pump, first we need to calculate the volumetric displacement. Here the volumetric displacement of the external gear pump can be found by knowing the volume of the hollow cylinder. In order to know the volume of the hollow cylinder, I am considering the gear. So here D naught, it is called as the external diameter of the gear teeth, and DI, it is called as the internal diameter of the gear teeth, and L, it is called as the length of the gear teeth. And the volumetric displacement, it is given by the formula pi by 4 into d naught square minus di square into the L in terms of meter cube per revolution. And in order to know the what is mean by the theoretical flow rate, it is nothing but volumetric displacement into speed of the RPM. So that is meter cube per revolution into revolution per minute. That means theoretical flow rate in terms of meter per minute. So this is the formula regarding to the calculation of volumetric displacement as well as the theoretical flow rate. Okay, so in the very first problem, they are asking about a gear pump has a gears of 80 mm and 50 mm outside and inside diameter. That means here D naught is equal to 80 millimeter, that is 0.08 meters. And DI, it is 50 millimeter, and that will be equal to 0.05 meters. And the gear teeth width 25 millimeter. The gear teeth width, it is nothing but 25 millimeter. That is 0.025 meters. So what is the volumetric efficiency? So volumetric efficiency we need to calculate. And when the pump running at speed of 1800 rpm, so these are the data they have given, and the volumetric efficiency, it is nothing but actual flow rate divided by theoretical flow rate into 100. And they are also given the rated discharge. That means here the actual flow rate, it is 0.105 meter cube per minute. Okay, so first I need to calculate the volumetric efficiency. So in order to know the volumetric efficiency, first we need to calculate what is meant by the theoretical flow rate. And in order to know the theoretical flow rate, first we need to calculate what is meant by the volumetric displacement of the fluid. And the formula for the volumetric displacement, it is nothing but pi by 4 into d naught square minus di square into L. Okay, first Vd is equal to pi by 4 into d naught square minus di square into L. That is pi by 4, 0.08 square minus 0.05 square, length is equal to 0.025. So calculate Vd. So substitute the values, 0.08 square minus 0.05 square into 0.025 into pi divided by 4. So Vd is equal to, that means volumetric displacement is equal to 7.657 into 10 to the power of 5 meter cube per revolution. Okay, so this is the volume of volumetric displacement. Then I need to calculate what is meant by the theoretical flow rate. Qt is equal to Vd into n, that is 7.657 into 10 to the power of minus 5 at 1800 rpm. So Qt is equal to, that is 0.1378 meter cube per minute. So in the problem, they are asking what is the volumetric efficiency. So volumetric efficiency of the external gear pump, it is Qa by Qt into 100. So what is Qa? 0.105 and QT, it is 0.1378 into 100. Therefore, volumetric efficiency
0.105 divided by 0.1378 into 100, that is 76.19%,
and approximately is equal to 77%. So this is the volumetric efficiency of the external gear pump. Okay, so next we are moving on to the second problem. It is called, your gear pump has a gears of external and internal diameters of 75 millimeter and 50 millimeters. Denote it as 75 millimeter and 50 millimeter, and the same width is equal to 25 millimeters. So that is 0.075, 0.05 and 0.025 meters of length, internal diameter and external diameter, and here the volumetric efficiency they have given, that is 90%. So what is the actual flow rate in this problem? They are asking about the QA of the pump. If the speed of the pump, it is 1000 rpm. Okay, so now I need to calculate the what is mean by the actual flow rate. That means QA by QT into 100. Okay, so first I need to calculate the QT. So in order to calculate the QT, first we need to calculate what is mean by the volumetric displacement. So what is the formula for volumetric displacement? That is pi by 4 into d naught square minus di square into L. That is pi by 4 into 0.075 whole square minus 0.05 whole square into 0.025. Okay, calculate the volumetric displacement. Okay, 0.075 minus 0.05 square into 0.025 into pi divided by 4, that is 6.1359 into 10 to the power of minus 5 meter cube per revolution. Okay, then I need to calculate QT, that is VD into N, that is 6.135 into 10 to the power of minus 5 into 1000, that is theoretical flow rate 0.061 meter cube per minute. Now substitute the value of QT in volumetric efficiency. So that is QA by QT into 100. So in order to know what is mean by the QA, so that is nothing but volumetric efficiency into QT divided by 100. That is 90 into 0.0613 divided by 100. So QA that is 0.055 meter cube per minute. But observe here, in this formula they are asking the what is the actual flow rate of the pump in terms of liters per minute. Okay, so here I need to calculate the actual flow rate in terms of liters per minute, so that I want to multiply 0.055 into 1000, that is 55.2 liters per minute. So we all know that 1 liter is equal to 1000 meter cubes. Okay, so this is regarding to the numerical 2 on external gear pump. Okay, so very important one, in case of the external gear pump, in order to know the volumetric displacement, first we need to know what is the volume of the hollow cylinder. So volume of the hollow cylinder is given by the formula pi by 4 d naught square minus di square into L. Then theoretical flow rate is equal to volumetric displacement into the speed of the RPM. Then volumetric efficiency is equal to QA by QT into 100. So substitute the values, and then in the numerical too, we can also calculate the actual flow rate in terms of liters per minute. That is nothing but 1 liter is equal to 1000 meter cube. Multiply with 1000, then 0.552 into 1000 will be become 55.2 LPM. So this is regarding to the numericals on external gear pump. The next thing, it is called the numericals on the vane pump. So in case of the vane pump also, very important parameter, it is called the calculation of the volumetric displacement of the vane pump. So in order to know the volumetric displacement of the vane pump, so we need to consider the parts of the vane pump like chambering, rotor, as well as the width of the vane. So width of the vane, it is nothing but L, and here diameter of the chambering, it is called DC, and diameter of the rotor, it is called DR. But very important one, it is called, in case of the vane pump, the axis of the rotor as well as the axis of the chambering, it's not one and the same, and there will be some kind of eccentricity will going to achieve in case of the vane pump. So then how to calculate the volumetric displacement of the vane pump? We all know that volumetric displacement is nothing but pi by 4 DC square minus DR square into the L, and pi by 4 into DC plus DR into DC minus DR into the L. But we know that what is mean by the eccentricity. Eccentricity is nothing but DC minus DR, and maximum eccentricity we can achieve, that is called DC minus DR by 2. Okay, so this will be, we need to consider the maximum eccentricity. Okay, so what is mean by the DC minus DR? So DC minus DR, it is nothing but DC minus DR, it is nothing but 2 times of maximum eccentricity. So VD is equal to pi by 4 DC plus DR into 2 times of maximum eccentricity into L. Here 2 ones are, 2 fours are, is going to cancel. Therefore volumetric displacement is equal to pi by 2 DC plus DR into Emax into L. So we can consider Emax is equal to EL for the assumptions. So this is the volumetric displacement for the vane pump. So now consider the data. Here the diameter of the rotor, that is DR, is equal to 50 millimeter, and that will be is equal to 0.05 meters. And chambering 80 millimeters, and that will be is equal to 0.08 meters. And width is equal to 30 millimeter, and that will be is equal to 0.03 meters. And we need to calculate. So what is volumetric displacement and eccentricity? It is 8 millimeter, and that will be is equal to 0.008 meters. Okay, so then now calculate the volumetric displacement, that is pi by 2 into DC plus DR into E into L. So that is pi by 2 DC, it is called 0.08 plus 0.05, E it is 8 millimeters, and that will be is equal to 0.008, and length is equal to 0.03. So calculate the volumetric displacement. Okay,
0.08 plus 0.05 into pi into 0.08 into 0.03 divided by 2, and that will be is equal to 4.9 into 00 into 10 to the power of minus 5 meter cube per revolution. This is regarding to the volumetric displacement of the vane pump. Now we are moving on to the second problem of the vane pump. So in the vane second problem, your vane pump has a rotor diameter, that is DR, that will be is equal to 60 millimeter, and that will be is equal to 0.06, and diameter of the cam ring, that is equal to 80 millimeter, and that will be is equal to 0.08. and here the volumetric displacement I have given, that is 90 centimeter cube per revolution, and take it as 90 into 10 to the power of minus 6 meter cube per revolution for the conversion from centimeter into the meters. Okay, so next it is called the width, it is called 3 centimeters, that is L is equal to 3 centimeter and that will be is equal to 0.03 meters. And then what is the eccentricity? First we need to calculate the eccentricity and maximum volumetric displacement. Okay, so first apply the basic formula, Vd is equal to pi by 2 dc plus dr into E into L. So we are applying this formula. So I need to calculate what is the eccentricity. So in order to know the eccentricity, so that will be equal to 2 times of Vd divided by pi into dc plus dr into L. 2 into 90 into 10 to the power of minus 6 divided by pi into 0.06 plus 0.08 into 0.03. So calculate the eccentricity. It will be is equal to 180 into 10 to the power of minus 6 into 0.06 plus 0.08 into 0.03 into pi, that is 0.01319. So here 180 into 10 to the power of minus 6 divided by 0.1319. So that will be equal to eccentricity, it is 0.0136 meters and that will be equal to 13.6 millimeters is the eccentricity. So now I need to calculate what is the maximum volumetric displacement. For the maximum volumetric displacement, formula will become, take this one. So this is the maximum volumetric displacement, that is pi by 2 into dc plus dr into E max into L. But what is mean by the maximum eccentricity? So maximum eccentricity, it is nothing but dc minus dr by 2. So what is the diameter of the cambering? The diameter of the cambering, it is 0.08 minus 0.06 divided by 2, that will be is equal to 0.01 is the maximum eccentricity. So now substitute maximum eccentricity in this formula, that is maximum volumetric displacement is equal to pi by 2 plus 0.08 plus 0.06 into 0.01 into 0.03. Therefore maximum volumetric displacement, that is 0.14 into 0.01 into 0.03 into pi divided by 2. So that will be equal to 6.597 into 10 to the power of minus 5 meter cube per revolution. So this is the maximum volumetric displacement can achieve from the vane pump. So this is regarding to the numericals on vane pump. The next topic in the module 2, it is called it as the accumulator. So what is mean by the accumulator? That is very much important. Accumulator, it's a device that stores the potential energy of the incompressible fluid by means of either gravity, mechanical spring or the compressed gases. So this is called it as the accumulator. So what is the main purpose of using the accumulator? So accumulator can be used as a secondary source of fluid power that will be capable of doing the useful work required by the system in order to operate the actuator. So that is regarding to the accumulator. So what is the main applications regarding to the accumulator? So accumulator can be used as a secondary power source, then accumulator can be also used to eliminate the pressure pulsation, then accumulator it is also used to can be obtained the emergency power source, then it will be also used to eliminate the hydraulic shocks. So these are the some of the applications regarding to the accumulator. So then very much important thing, it is called it as the classification of the accumulator. So what is mean by the
Accumulator, that means we are already know. So accumulator, it is used to store the potential energy of the hydraulic fluid for the longer period of time without keep on running the pump. So that is called it as the accumulator. So accumulators are mainly classified into weight loaded accumulator, then spring loaded accumulator, then gas loaded accumulator. So the gas loaded accumulator itself can be categorized into two types, that is called non-separator type of accumulator and the separator type of accumulator. So in the separator type of accumulator, it is further classified into three types. The one, it is called piston type of accumulator. Second one, it is called diaphragm type of accumulator. And third one, it is called bladder type of accumulator. Okay, so now we are studying the very first one. It is called weight loaded type of accumulator. So what is mean by the weight loaded type of accumulator? So it is the oldest type of accumulator. So it mainly consists of a piston or a ram, and it is placed inside the vertically mounted accumulator. Okay, so it consists of the piston or a ram, and it is placed inside the vertically mounted accumulator. Piston is provided with a platform over dead weights are provided in order to obtain the potential energy. Then very important one, it is called, so in case of the weight loaded accumulator, so hydraulic fluid from the pump, it is enters into the bottom end of the cylinder through the check valve. I repeat, in case of the weight loaded accumulator, so during its operation, hydraulic fluid from the pump, it is enters into the bottom end of the cylinder through the one way check valve. Once it is enters into the bottom of the cylinder, then this will going to pushes the piston upwards. Once the piston pushes upwards, then the potential energy is going to store. Then whatever the dead weights are placed over the platform of the piston exerts the pressure on the piston. Okay, so whatever the dead weights placed over the platform of the piston exerts the pressure on the hydraulic fluid, and the pressure exerted by the piston or a ram on the hydraulic fluid can be calculated. That is, the pressure exerted by the piston or a ram on the hydraulic fluid can be calculated with the help of the weight placed on the platform of the piston to the area of the piston contact with the fluid. So therefore, in case of the weight loaded accumulator, here the constant pressure is going to exert on the hydraulic fluid. Okay, so whatever the constant pressure exerted on the hydraulic fluid, then it is sent to the hydraulic system in order to operate the actuator. So this is regarding to the weight loaded accumulator. So what is the main advantage of weight loaded accumulator? That is very much important. So the main advantage, it is called, it is going to supply the constant pressure of oil in order to operate the actuators. And the main disadvantage in case of the weight loaded accumulator, it is called it as, here it is very large and heavy, hence it is not suitable for mobile or portable application. So that is regarding to the weight loaded accumulator. Then second one, what is mean by the spring loaded accumulator? Spring loaded accumulator, it operates in the same manner of the weight loaded accumulator, except that here spring is preloaded with the piston, and here the potential energy is stored in the spring loaded accumulator in the form of compression spring. And here the spring loaded accumulator, it operates in the principle of compression rate of the spring. Okay, so observe here, in operation, the hydraulic fluid under pressure from the pump, it is enters into the bottom end of the cylinder through the one way check valve. When this hydraulic fluid, it is rushes into the bottom end of the cylinder, this pushes the piston upwards, hence the compression of the spring is going to take place. So whatever the compression of the spring is going to take place inside the accumulator, that will going to store the potential energy. This compression force, or this compressed pressure, is then exerts on the piston into the hydraulic fluid, that will going to pushes the hydraulic fluid into this hydraulic system in order to operate the actuators. So that is called it as the spring loaded accumulator. Okay, I repeat, in case of the spring loaded accumulator, here hydraulic fluid under pressure, so from the pump, it is enters into the bottom end of the cylinder through the one-way check valve. Then this pushes the piston upwards. Then compression of the spring is going to take place. Due to the compression, pressure is going to increase. Then this compression pressure is then applied on the hydraulic fluid through the piston, and that pushes the piston downwards, as well as the hydraulic fluid. Then it is transferred into the hydraulic system in order to actuate the actuators. So this is regarding to the spring-loaded accumulators. Then what is the main thing in case of the spring loaded accumulator. So spring loaded accumulators is going to supply only the small volume of air at low pressure. Why? Because, and it is not suitable for high pressure rates, because you are going to use the spring. So the spring, it is because of the elasticity, it will go into fatigue and it will make the accumulator is inoperative. That's why spring loaded accumulator, it is suitable for only to supply the small volume of air at low pressure. Then it is called it as third one, gas loaded accumulator. So what is mean by the gas loaded accumulator? In case of the gas loaded accumulator, very important thing it is called, your force is exerted on the oil with the help of the compressed gases. Okay, so that means the gas loaded accumulator, it is operates on the principle of the Boyle's law. So what is mean by the Boyle's law? Boyle's law, it is nothing but at constant temperature, the pressure of the gas is inversely proportional to the volume of the gas in the accumulator. So that means, for example, if the volume of the accumulator, it is get cut in half, then pressure will going to double. So that is the main thing we are going to observe in case of the gas loaded accumulator. So in the gas loaded accumulator itself, there are two types. The one, it is called non-separator type, other one, it is called separator type. So what is meant by the non-separator type of accumulator? So this is called non-separator type of gas loaded accumulator. Okay, so what happens in case of the non-separator type of gas loaded accumulator? Here, there is no barrier between the gas and the oil. That means oil and the gas are completely going to mix us together. That means in case of the gas loaded accumulator, it completely consists of a closed steel shell. Okay, and it contains the oil port at the bottom and gas charging valve at the top. Okay, so this is regarding to the non-separator type of gas loaded accumulator. That means here, because of there is no separation between the oil and the gas, here gas is directly pushes the oil. Therefore, the main advantages, it is called the non-separator type of gas loaded accumulator. It is mainly used to operate the large volume of air or large volume of hydraulic fluid. Okay, but the main disadvantage, it is called here the absorption of gas in the oil. If there is any absorption of gas in the oil, then this will go into causes the entrapment of gases in the oil, then it is not recommended for high speed pump, because this will go into causes the pump cavitation and this will go into erode the blades of the pump, as well as the this will go into causes the problem in the components of the hydraulic pump. That's why it is not suitable for high speed pumps. Then separator type. So what is mean by the separator type of accumulator? In case of the separator type of accumulator, there is a barrier between oil and the gas. Then this barrier, it is used to achieve the effectively compressibility of the gases. Okay, so there are three types. The one, it is called piston type of accumulator. Second one, it is called diaphragm type of accumulator. And third one, it is called as the bladder type of accumulator. So what happens in case of the piston type of accumulator? It is very simple. It consists of the closed cylinder with the freely floating piston with the help of the proper seal. And here, piston, it acts as a barrier between the nitrogen gas and the hydraulic fluid. Okay, so in operation here, the gas, it is enters into the nitrogen gas, it is enters into the gas chamber with the gas charging valve. Hence, the piston is going to move downwards. So after that, once the pre-charging pressure is going to achieve inside the gas chamber, then hydraulic fluid from the pump, it is enters into the oil chamber through the oil port. Okay, whenever the hydraulic fluid from the pump, it is enters into the oil chamber through the oil port, and this will going to push us the piston upwards. Once the piston is going to move upwards, this will going to cause us the compressibility of the gases. Due to the compressibility of the gases, the volume is going to decreases and pressure is going to increases, and this will going to stores the potential energy. Whatever the potential energy is stored in the gas, whatever the potential energy is stored in the gas, it is then applied on the hydraulic fluid and thus will going to transfer into the hydraulic system in order to operate the actuators. So this is called as the piston type of accumulator. Okay, so next, second one, what is mean by the diaphragm type of accumulator? In case of the diaphragm type of accumulator, the nitrogen gas as well as the hydraulic fluid are going to separated with the help of the rubber diaphragm. And very important one, it is called, in case of the diaphragm type of accumulator, a shut off button is provided at the bottom of the diaphragm, and this will going to avoid the damage during the pre-charging. So that means during the pre-charging, whatever the gas enters into the gas chamber, and that will going to pushes the
shut off button to the oil port. So if this causes the damage to the oil port, then it is ineffective. That's why the shut off button it is provided in order to avoid the damage during the pre-charging. Okay, so operation is very simple here. Initially through the gas charging valve, the nitrogen gas it is enters into the gas chamber and this diaphragm it is moved downwards. Once the pre-charging pressure is achieved inside the gas chamber, then oil from the pump it is enters into the oil chamber through the oil port, and this will causes the deformation of the diaphragm. So due to the deformation of the diaphragm, then the compressibility of the gases is going to achieve. So due to the compressibility of the gases, the volume is going to decrease and the pressure is going to increase. Then highly pressurized gas, then it is applied on the hydraulic fluid in order to transfer the hydraulic fluid into the hydraulic system to operate the actuators. So the main advantages in case of the diaphragm type of accumulator, it is the small in weight to larger volume ratio. Okay, light in weight and small volume to weight ratio can be achieved in case of the diaphragm type of accumulator, and it is also suitable for airborne application. Last one, bladder type of accumulator. So in case of the bladder type of accumulator, here the rubber bladder it is going to separate the nitrogen gas as well as the hydraulic fluid. Okay, so initially the nitrogen gas is filled into the bladder through the gas charging valve. Once the pre-charge pressure is achieved inside the rubber bladder, then hydraulic fluid it is then enters into the oil chamber through the oil port from the pump. So whenever hydraulic fluid is enters into the oil chamber through the oil port, then this bladder will going to contract. So due to the contraction of the bladder, so here compressibility of the gas is going to achieve, hence the pressure is going to increases. Okay, so then this highly pressurized gas, then it is applied on the hydraulic fluid in order to transfer the hydraulic fluid into the hydraulic system and to actuate the actuators. Okay, so the very important advantage in case of the bladder type of accumulator, it is called, there is a positive seal between the nitrogen gas and the hydraulic fluid. That means there is no leakage. Okay, then the quick response can be achieved in case of the bladder type of accumulator. Hence, it is mainly suitable for eliminates the pressure pulsation as well as it can also eliminate the hydraulic shocks. So this is regarding to the bladder type of accumulator. Okay, so these are the some of the different types of accumulators what we are going to use in the hydraulic system in order for the effective function. Okay, and the main applications of the accumulators what we are going to use, it is called, so accumulators are mainly used as a secondary power source, then it can be also used for the emergency power source, then it can be also used for the compensator for the internal and external leakage, and it will also used as the hydraulic shock absorber. So this is regarding to the application of the accumulators. Thank you.